Good afternoon, sir. This evening we will be discussing Budget 2018. I am Cynthia James, 1122.
I am Abdul Halim, 1229.
I am Avinash Pillai, 1247.
I am Vineet Chakma, 1120.
I am Dorothy Das, 1174.
My name is Prashamsa, I am 1238.
So today we will be discussing the budget, and why this discussion is important going forward is because right now we are the fifth largest economy in the world, and this is a budget that comes right after GST and demonetization. So as a nation, it's important for us to understand the impact that these initiatives has had on our economy and how the government is responding to such effects. And the next thing is, right now currently we are having the lowest growth rate under Modi's government rule, and we also, this is will be the last budget, might be the last budget before the next election. So how we are performing as an economy right now will have a direct correlation with the results of our coming election. So starting with this entire panel discussion, we will go in process and each panel member will introduce a certain part of the budget and explain it to us before we go forward with the discussion.
So today I'm going to be the SME for agriculture and rural market. So why is it important? The majority of our population live in the rural market, and their major income is from agriculture. And being most probably a budget just before the election, this carries a lot of weight. So Modi government had promised that the income of the farmers will double by 2022. But if you look at the statistics, it's not that looking good. The growth rate for farmers is 1.3% currently. When it was UPA, it was 3.7%. So if we have to achieve the target of 22%, we have to grow at the rate of 14% in the rural market, which is very ambitious. So to attain that thing, a lot of things has to be done. So this budget had, so we will see what the budget has done to achieve this goal of 2022.
Avinash, could you
With respect to the infrastructure, it's first essential for us to understand that we need investments in excess of 50 lakh crores in order for the country infrastructure to increase the growth of the GDP and also to connect and integrate the country's transport system. Other than that, the budgeting allocation for infrastructure is set at ₹5.99 lakh crores. An all-time high allocation has been made, especially in the rails and the roadway sector, wherein they really want to improve the railway network and the roadways across India. Also, what's interesting to note is that you have this Pragati project. Pragati is like a program that monitors and facilitates fast track of the projects worth 9.46 crores. Another initiative is the Smart Cities and the Missions project that's worth 2350 crores, and also that's been completed, and the projects worth 20,852 crores are still under progress. So a total of 99 cities have been selected under this mission, and an outlay of 2.4 lakh crores has been set.
Dorothy, if you could introduce your part.
I'll be talking about the health and education sector in the union budget. So I'll be saying few key points that has been included in our budget. This very crucial point for health and education. One is that in a budget expenditure on health and education, the previous year it was the previous year's expenditure was only 1.38 lakh crores, I'm sorry. But this year it has been increased by 15,000 crore by allocation during the year. So you can see there is an increase of allocation of expenditure during this year. Now again, one more important point in the budget for the health and education sector is government has in the education sector, government has introduced a program called RISE. RISE is the full form of the RISE is revitalizing infrastructure and system in education, which has an investment of 1 lakh crore for the next 4 years. Now when it comes to the health sector, the government has introduced a scheme called National Health Protection Scheme, which will be launched across 10 million poor families, and it will be covering some around 5 lakh million individuals, like 5 lakh million families. So yes, it is a program which is one of the largest government funded health program, and it has been taking references from the Barack Obama, when Barack Obama was there during his tenure, Barack Obama health program. So this is one of the key points.
Thank you, Dorothy. Prashamsa?
So I'll be talking about tourism sector.
which is often neglected in the budget previous. It was neglected in the previous budget also. And this year also, there's no focus on the budget this sector much. An amount of 2,150 crore was allocated to the Ministry of Tourism under the Union Budget 18-19, receiving a 21% jump from the current fiscal year. So, which is not very, when you see, look at the numbers, which is not too much. Government has always, they have ignored this sector. I don't know why, because India earns a lot from tourism also. Within these projects, integrated development of tourist circuits and has been allocated rupees 1,100 crores. From last year it was 950 crores, so it is okay, but it's not a very good number, you see. And so they have focused on temples and rejuvenations and spiritual tourism more than the others. But I don't see a point why only spiritual tourism is considered and not others, because there are a lot of places in India you can go. Also, in the budget speech, Finance Minister Arun Jaitley said that government is proposing to develop 10 prominent tourist sites into iconic tourist destination, involving infrastructure and skill development of technology, and attracting private sector investment in those 10 prominent areas. So, which is a good thing, but then how did the number 10 come in? There are a lot of explanation I seek to it, because why is there only 10 sites that need development, and how did they come up with these fact numbers? Because they haven't clearly stated which areas or what areas they'll be working on, but they just mentioned 10 prominent areas. So yeah, for the initial part, from my personal view, I think more should be more budgets should be allocated to this sector also.
Thank you, Karina. Chakma, could you please introduce yourself?
Everyone looks forward to one of the main areas while the budget speech is being made. It's the employment generation. Everyone's affected by it. So currently you see a reduction of 30% is allowed in addition to normal reduction of your 100% in respect to enrollment of all the paid eligible to new employees who have been just employed for a minimum period of 240 days during the year. Okay, but then you see, however, this minimum period of employment is relaxed to 150. So you see a substantial deduction has been made in the percentage and in the days where the employee can benefit more from it. This has been done especially in the apparel sections, where the industry is right now on a very stagnant position. So this is done in order to create and encourage more new employment. And it was also proposed to extend this relaxation to all the leather and the footwear industries. Further, it was proposed that the rationalization of this reduction of 30% by allowing the benefit for a year employee who is employed for less than that specific period of time which was provided. So it continues to help the individuals to get more employed, but not in a very substantial way.
So going forward, another important part of the budget that we as a panel should be discussing is the Digital India Initiative, transforming India into a knowledge economy. So our government started this initiative around the 90s and 2000s, and they have gone ahead with it, although the progress is not as fast as they would have expected. And this is an important initiative for us to think about and go ahead with, because what this is doing essentially is we are connecting our entire country, and we are enabling people in the rural parts of our country so that they get empowered and they're part of the growth of our entire economy. So the budget allocation for this Digital India program is around 373 crores. And a national program will be initiated by Niti Aayog to increase efforts in the area of artificial intelligence. And the mission of cyber physical systems will be launched by the Department of Science and Technology, under which centers of excellence for research, training and skilling, robotics, artificial intelligence and big data analysis, quantum communication and Internet of Things will be established and promoted. and the budget allocation of rupees 10,000 crores is made in the 2018 budget. For the telecom infrastructure is also one very crucial essential part of connecting our entire country and enabling our citizens. And 500,000 Wi-Fi hotspots will be set up by the government to provide internet connectivity to over 5 million rural citizens. So we will also be discussing this as a part of our entire budget going forward. So starting with the discussion, I would like to start with Abdul. Abdul, please enlighten us on what are the main policy changes regarding agriculture in this year's budget.
So this is agriculture budget. The main thing we have all heard about is minimum support price. So what does it do? So basically, if a farmer has spent like 100 rupees to produce like one kg of rice, the government will buy it for 150 rupees. So prima facie, it looks really good.
Yeah, it looks really nice.
So that's what we all hear in the media. So the problem is there are a lot of loopholes in this. The first thing is like how you calculate your cost. There are two ways to calculate it. One is what is called a payload expense. Is it how much have you actually given to like buy the seeds or for the fertilizer, things like that. Next is the comprehensive approach, which so if you are going by the payload expense, the problem is that the gain that we are talking about, the 1.5% raise, is nothing, it's very negligible. So there is no much improvement in farmers' pay. Now if you are going for the comprehensive, which means that it's the payload expense plus the unpaid family labor. So basically, he's not working himself, he'll be having his brother, friends working for him in the field. So we will be actually taking care of the calculating their pay as well and giving him the 1.5%. At that point, what happens, there will be a food price inflation. That's the worst kind of, one of the worst kind of inflation that we can have. Now the government also knows this thing, there can be an inflation. But the problem is the government has only allocated 200 crores, which is nothing to handle this kind of inflation in a country with 1.3 billion population. So this can, I don't think this can turn out to be a huge problem. So we need more information regarding these things, which is not yet available yet. So I believe when the financial bill is being put on the table, there will be a huge debate on all these topics. So, and one more thing is like, this is not the first time the budget is doing this thing.
Mm-hmm.
In the last year budget, the rabi crop were already included. Now they're just adding on to the kharif crops.
Mm-hmm.
And one important thing is like, so 1.5% increase. So let's see, it's a great thing.
Mm-hmm.
The most important thing that we are forgetting here is the government only buys 6% of the crops.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say like for what happens to the 94% of the other farmers. So that's still big unknown. So all this taking into account, we should have a very healthy debate on it. So that the farmers, so all this takes care of the post-production side of it. So we should have a much better understanding of all these schemes, particularly this scheme, to see how it will help achieve our 2022 target of doubling the farmers' income.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Abdul, for that. Moving ahead to Avinash, one question that we want to put forward to you is, as a part of dealing with the infrastructure of our economy, we know that a lot of people in our country are homeless. And how is the budget trying to deal with this? Is there anything they have done to address this issue this year?
Well, very well put, Sandhya. What I'd like to first draw your attention to is the fact that the reason we have not really budgeted a lot of money into the tourism sector is because India has a lot of problems that need to be first faced and, you know, solved within itself. And like you said, the homelessness is a really big problem because majority of the population is below the poverty line and you have so many homeless people out there. And it's a very interesting thing to note that in this budget, we have the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, wherein every poor is to have, the aim of this Yojana is that every poor will have a house by the year 2022. So they put 51 lakh rural houses and 37 lakh urban houses. But now, all of this sounds well and good when you put it into words. But execution is a big problem because if you look at it from past experience, there were also supposed to be a huge increase in the number of jobs. In a country that's as big as India, it's not very easy for us to execute these kind of things and have actual quantifiable results. And you can't really see all these results happening overnight. This is a process that's going to happen gradually over a period of time, and it needs some really hard, it needs a lot of hard work and dedication from the part of the government to actually make this happen by 2020. So I 2022. So I think it's a very ambitious aim that the government has had, and if it were to succeed, it would be something really good.
Mm-hmm.
So let's hope for the best.
Thank you for that, Avinash. Now going to Dorothy. Dorothy, you are dealing with the education part of the budget. So what do you think are the more prominent changes that this year's budget has introduced compared to last year's?
Thank you for the question, Cynthia. Firstly, I would say that this year's budget, 2018-19 budget, got to see in the admission sector, got to see a very drastic change. What happened in last year, it was 3% cents, which was actually implemented for the education sector. 2% cent was for the primary education, and 1% cents was for the secondary and the higher education, which was levied on the personal and the corporate taxes. So now this time Mr. Arun Jaitley has proposed to exit from this 3% education cents with the 4% education cents. So now what happens, this will make education and education more feasible, more accessible for the rural country, rural population of our country, taking care of this needs of education, for people for below poverty line and from rural families. This will enable them to avail the different sources of education, like beginning from the primary to secondary and the higher education. So here Arun Jaitley also said that by 2020, our BJP government will make sure that every block with more than 50% of ST population, at least 20,000 tribal people will be educated with the implementation of a school program called the Eklavya Model Residential School. So this is a kind of a program wherein people, rural education will be imparted. And again, government is also planning to integrate all the education sectors, like from primary to the higher education sector, primary to class 12. They'll be integrating every classes into one whole sector. Now, government has also implemented one more important thing, was that it has implemented all these schemes of education. We have various schemes of education in our education system by the government. Now, the HRD ministry has integrated flagship programs like Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan and Rashtriya Madhyamik Shiksha Abhiyan, which is a joint mandate to make the education more available to the rural population of our country.
Thank you, Dorothy, for that. Now going ahead to Vineet. Vineet, the question I have for you is, now we've dealt with different parts of the budget and how we are working towards improving certain areas of our economy, but obviously our senior citizens are also important, because eventually we all transition to that stage. So as an economy, as a government, what are we doing to ensure that the livelihoods of our senior citizens are maintained and are provided for?
This time, this emphasis has been provided and is being given to all the senior citizens. For example, let me quote, "To care for those who care for us is one of the highest honor," have been quoted by Arun Jaitley during his speech. And some incentives have been provided to the senior citizens regarding your transactions and your bank interest. For example, exemptions of interest income on deposits with bank and post offices has been increased from 10,000 to 15,000. And on top of that, TDA shall not be deducted when they claim this benefit. Okay, this benefit shall be available also for the interest for all fixed deposits and recurring deposits. Secondly, the rise in the limitations of a deduction for health insurances and Mediclaims, okay, has been topped up from 30,000 to 50,000 under the section 80-84DA, where all citizens will now be able to claim benefits and deductions up to 50,000 per annum, that is, in respect of health insurances, premiums, and on general health Mediclaims. Then they have raised the limitations of deduction of medical expenditures with respect to certain critical illnesses, that is, to 60,000. Okay, these concessions will give an extra tax benefit of 4,000 crores to all senior citizens. That's a lot for this. And then the Pradhan Mantri Vyan Vandana Yojana up to March 2020 has been proposed under the assurance that return on 8% of your Life Insurance Corporation of India. The existing limit on the investment right now is 7.5 lakhs per senior citizen under the scheme, and it's also enhanced to 15 lakhs.
Thank you, Chakma, for that. Circling back to Prashamsa. Prashamsa, the question that we have for you today is, should the private sector in private sector investment be led into sectors like tourism, as we have in this year's budget? What is your opinion?
Yes, in the, I also noticed that part where Arun Jaitley mentioned that, you know, they are looking forward for private investment in tourism sector this year. So the question I would raise is, are they, you know, because they have not allocated so much budget for this sector, are they looking for, you know, are they depending on the foreign investment to come for the, this particular sector? Talking about, would we need foreign investment? Yes, obviously, because tourism not only comprises of temples and tirth yatras that the people travel for, but then there are a lot of people who travel for leisure, a lot of people travel for adventure. So looking at, keeping that into account, there are you know, you need hotels, you don't need good infrastructure for the tourist. So, and I think as because India has such a big population, they don't need external tourists as much to hold the tourism economy. They are, you know, self-sufficient in that matter. You know, internal tourism is self-sufficient. So if you're focusing, because we've talked a lot about employment and generating employment opportunities, why cannot the government look into domestic tourism as a way of increasing employment? Very important. It is a very important element in this entire exercise. So I like to put a light on. So we've anticipated a growth achieved in domestic tourism. You need to see job creations to grow, and this job creation will have a multiplier effect as a result of that. So, you know, that gives you that multiplier effect of increasing the income of local people. So from this budget point of view, I would like to see a rationalization of aviation turbine fuel taxes under GST. You know, they need to cut taxes in the service sector also to, you know, see growth in that. The other thing I would like to put light on is that we need foreign investment in this particular sector, plus we need government to work to enhance this sector as well, you know, let it be through taxes, let it be investment. Someone needs to look after this sector too and not just ignore it, because it is a big sector on itself.
Thank you, Prashamsa, for that. Next question I would like to pose is to Abdul. Abdul, could you enlighten us on how the government is improving the rural market today?
Okay, for this year's budget for rural and agriculture together, the government has spending 14.423 lakh crores. This is a huge investment. And the government has actually raised the agriculture budget by 12.8%. And the rural sector market, they are actually raised by 1.8. That's very minimal. So what happened is, for agriculture budget, the increase is actually same as the last year. There's no actual increase. It's the same as last year. The increase last year and increase this year is the same. At the same time, last year increase for rural market was 19%. Now it has come down to 1.8%. So even though it's a huge amount, the increase in the focus is not that that much as you would expect. Being this is going to be the final or the penultimate budget that the NDA government is going to present. At the same time, what they are actually trying to do in the rural market is also trying to focus on the post-production sales of the agricultural products. So basically, they are creating 22,000 rural markets with a cost of 2,000 crore. At the same time, they are actually trying to combine all the small mandis into an ENAM scheme of 470. So basically, that means like a rural villager or a farmer in a very rural village can sell his product online. So the price is not going to be manipulated by the middleman. So that's a really good thing that's going to happen here. At the same time, we are facing the issues of climate changes currently. So to tackle this, government has increased the crop insurance by 21%, so that the person didn't worry about crop damage or rainfall. Now, when we're talking about the rural market, of what the government is trying to do there is by the Swachh Bharat program, they are creating two crore toilets. At the same time, by the Ujjwal Yojana, they are creating 8 crore LPG centers there. So each family will be having an LPG. So the problem of the smoke and the health issues due to that will be reduced drastically. At the same time, they are trying to provide electricity for a lot of villages, which is a huge scheme. Under the scheme, we are trying to give electricity to 4 crore people. So this is a huge undertaking in the rural and agriculture sector. So by doing all these things, in the next budget, we have to more focus on the rural and agriculture sector so that we can be on track to the 2022 target. It's easy said than done, because like currently we are going at 1.3% in the rural side. At the same time, to achieve that 2022, we have to grow at 14%. So it's a drastic change. So the focus should be more in these two sectors.
Thank you so much for that, Abdul. We have another follow-up question for Dorothy today, and that is, can you give us more insights on Modi Care introduced by Jaitley?
Okay, so this is one of the mega healthcare project that has been introduced by Mr. Arun Jaitley. It is nothing but the National Health Protective Scheme that I already said in my earlier discussion. So it is actually dubbed by Mr. Arun Jaitley as Modi Care. So the main objective of this whole scheme is to extend the healthcare insurance to around 100 million families, that raises insurance ceiling to 5 lakh per family. So this whole scheme targets around 500 million individuals from financial vulnerable household and or some demographic vulnerabilities for which they are not been able to avail those basic requirement of healthcare. Now, here what happens, this scheme will be facilitating healthcare in both secondary and tertiary. It is divided into two types of care, secondary and tertiary, in both the government and the private hospitals. Now, let me tell you what is secondary and tertiary healthcare. So, secondary healthcare is actually for the outpatients. We know that India has been a hub for healthcare for patients from different countries. From different the Middle East countries or for Bangladesh, Nepal, different people from different countries come here because we consider that India is by healthcare, our doctors are very good and they are very knowledgeable. So here what happens, they have created a scheme wherein outpatients will come here for treatment and can stay at the hospital for a very brief period. So this is kind of a scheme that they have introduced. And another care is the tertiary care, where this is for patients which are admitted to hospitals for suffering from acute pain or a very longer period of illness, a very serious illness. So this is a two type of care that our government is being providing in the healthcare sector. Now, one more important scheme is the Rashtriya Swasth Bima Yojana, which is an affordable healthcare scheme that provides an insurance of 30,000 for a family comprising of at least 5 members. Okay. So this is actually a precursor for the Modi Care, that is actually the main target audience is the BPL families. So this is the most important point.
Can I have just a comment? So earlier you compared Modi Care with Obamacare. So but what happened with Obamacare is Obama ran first in their presidential campaign on Obamacare. So they had a huge discussion about this. But India never got to have this discussion. We are introducing the biggest healthcare scheme India had ever seen. So, but no one had any discussion about this, no one ever debated this. At the same time, the issue is 40% of this Modi Care or National Healthcare Protection Scheme is being funded by the state government. So, Mamata Banerjee clearly said that she is not going to pay for it. So, what happens then? No one knows, because no one has ever debated this topic. So, there are states like Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Andhra who already has insurance scheme. What happens to this insurance scheme? Does it go away and is it all covered under Modi? Or will we have two separate state and national insurance scheme? No one ever knows, because no one ever talked about it. So I think that's one big huge pitfall of this thing is we never had discussed this, we never had heard about this until Arun Jaitley has told us. So I believe in the financial bill being put on, we should be having a healthy discussion, because all these things has to be sorted out, especially when it comes to state funding 40% of it. What if some state government backs out, and what is the next process? All this has to be taken care of.
So jumping into the discussion, we see two things happening here. We see the government taking certain initiatives like GST and demonetization, and on the other side, they are setting certain targets and goals like 2020 goals and doubling farmers' income and all these goals. So the question really is, as an economy, we have said that these are things that we want to achieve, and we are taking certain steps together through the budget and through certain financial policies. So are they really taking us towards the goal? That's the question that we need to ask and discuss today. And each and every initiative that we have seen introduced through the budget, is it taking us towards a goal, and is it feasible? The feasibility of the goal has also to be questioned. So is it wrong as a part of a government to make such unattainable targets, or are we making mistakes in the pace at which we are going about attaining these targets? That's one thing that we need to discuss today.
So yes, to add on the point, whenever politicians speak about these targets or demonetization or achieving the doubling the income, something like that, they always say in the long run it will be all okay, in the long run we will be achieving. But as former Prime Minister just said, in the long term, who cares beyond that? So we should be having targets, like each year we should be achieving, like if it's 2022 we are going to double it, what will be the farmer's income in 2020? What will be the farmer's income in 2019? Is it achieved? Or what is the variation? So how much should we inject more to achieve this variation? Because we don't have the small steps, we don't actually, we plan for the long term, but we never plan for the short term. So we don't have anything to challenge this government and ask like, where is the results? So that's a huge problem, because even the main target is the 2020 doubling the farmer's income. But the main thing that's going to happen in 2018 or 2019 is the next election is going to come in. So probably since we don't have a short-term target, the current government can easily say that we in the long run we will achieve it. But what about in the short term? What's happened in the short term? The demonetization has hugely affected the rural market. How have they come up properly? Is the issues there solved? All these are current questions that the budget and the ministers should answer.
Adding to that, Avinash, also could you please shed some light on, you brought up the point of the feasibility of the infrastructure scheme, and how, you know, we're a country, as a nation, we're a large country, and to make some promises and to work towards a goal, we might not be able to achieve certain goals. So how do you think we're doing as a nation with our budget?
I like the second what Abdul just said. The government keeps telling us that all of these things, they come with really revolutionary ideas that sound good on paper, and they say that all of this is going to be good in the long term for us as a country. But I need you all to think about this one very carefully. What exactly is long term? Because if you think about it, you could be dead tomorrow. We need contingency plans and plans of action to get things in moving from tomorrow. Because if you keep saying that this is going to be fine in the next 100 years, 50 years, what is going to happen in the next 10 years? People are still going to be suffering. In fact, I think that people will be suffering even more than they are right now, because the whole period of change is going to be really difficult. There is a certain inertia involved in this, and making such radical changes or revolutionary changes is not easy. And in order for the government, it's upon the government to be able to take care of the people and guide them through the change in a step-by-step process. So I think that the government needs to set shorter targets and really, you know, come up with a plan wherein you have your short-term intervals wherein they achieve this long-term in short-term intervals with quantifiable results. Because other than that, I don't really see anything happening. People are still going to suffer.
Dorothy, one final question I'd like to ask you as well is, you compared our budget with Obamacare, right? And the one thing that we need to take note of is the US as a country and as a government has executed their healthcare system in a certain way. So compared to that way of execution, do you think us as a country, we can achieve such levels of execution and maybe even do it better when it comes to the targets that we've set?
Thank you, Sadhya. I'd like to start my answer like, there is never late to learn from anyone. So US was the first head start to introduce such a big program, as you said, Barack Obama healthcare program. So US has first started it. So yes, maybe our government did have a pre-discussion
discussion to like introduce such a big topic, such a big scheme in India, country like India, size of our Indian population and the nature and the way and the behavioral nature of our Indian people. So yes, our government might not be taking a discussion, pre-discussion. It might be too early start for it. But I think there is never late to discuss it, discuss its good points. As Abdul was saying me, that comparing Barack Obama's program and our Modi Care program, there's a vast difference. I know it's a vast difference. US and India, there's a vast difference. But I think there can be more discussion on it later on. There might not be like recent developments or recent like outcomes from this scheme, but still I think from learning from that US healthcare program will help us a lot to develop the healthcare, because healthcare industry is one such booming industry. It is not only giving employment, it is also giving revenue to our country, because people from outside countries are also coming here to go for other various kind of health programs.
So adding on to the point, so basically what should be our learning? Is it the learning that we learned in 2010 when Obamacare was introduced, or is it the learning that 2017 was when Obamacare was repealed and replaced by the Trump government? So there are two sides of it. One side says that the universal healthcare is beneficial for everyone, and the other side says, why should we pay for others? Like, if I am having disease, I will go to the hospital, but why should I pay for the others? So this is the global discussion that is going on, and I probably feel that we will be also having the same thing here. At the same time, there are one important thing is the insurance. This is an insurance scheme. So basically, a lot of insurance companies are definitely going to get rich. At the same time, we should also we make very. This is what happened in US. The insurance companies actually, the insurance premium doubled or quadrupled, and these insurance companies actually became more, very very wealthy. So we should actually see what's the system, proper system in India we can adopt, so that this thing won't happen, and the actual intended people, the poor people, the people below BPL can actually get the intended healthcare that they want, desperately want.
Thank you, Abdul, for that. As a final point, what we'd like to add is we can see all these initiatives being taken care of, that we're trying to improve the rural economy, we're trying to improve the education provided to our people and our healthcare and everything. So what I also think we need to do is focus on digitizing our economy. I've mentioned previously that the growth rate has been not as fast as we expected it to be, but the point I'd like to make is that digitizing our entire country and making connectivity available for people everywhere will also improve their chances of educating themselves, also improve their chances of probably getting more jobs, and also being more aware of how to improve their livelihoods. So that being said, that we as a country can also focus on this particular initiatives, included, as a part of the initiatives that we take in improving our entire country's economy. So, Abdul, if you could just conclude the entire discussion.
So there are a lot of great schemes which have come through this year's budget, like the minimum support price, or the healthcare, Pravas Avas Yojana, or the greatest push in ever seen in educating the rural side. So these all has to be implemented, and there should be short-term checks to see how well these things have been implemented. So great things never happen easily. Great people have to do it, and I do believe that India has a lot of great people and a lot of great officers who can achieve all this target and bring us to the goal of 2020, and will be having a great country.
With that, we would like to end this discussion. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.